We've been talking about sequences and series for quite a while now. The big payoff is the idea of Taylor series. Now, a Taylor series is just a power series for a function around a point. It's if you can write a function as an infinite power series, then we say that this is the Taylor series for the original function. Now, a Maclaurin series is the same thing, only instead of doing it around x equals a, it's when you do things around x equals 0. And these are the simplest kinds of power series that you have, and most of the standard formulas that you see are actually Maclaurin series. You just have powers of x, like e to the x is 1 plus x squared over 2, and so on. Now, actually, both names are misnomers. Newton did both things long before Taylor or Maclaurin, but this just goes to show a general principle in mathematics. If somebody's name is attached to something, the odds are somebody else did it first. So, the questions that we have about these infinite power series are, if a function is equal to its power series, how can you figure out the coefficients? Now, we've got a special term here, analytic. An analytic function is a function that can be expressed as an infinite power series. We're going to see that lots of very common functions can be expressed as power series, but some can't. So we're talking about analytic functions, and we want to figure out how can we figure out what all of their coefficients are. And then we're going to take our common functions. We know functions like e to the x and sine x and cosine x and arcsine and arctangent, and there are lots and lots of standard functions, and we want to get the series that correspond to those functions. They come up a lot, they're extremely useful, they're worth memorizing. The next question is, what if you don't want an infinite series? After all, an infinite series is just the limit of a finite series as you take more and more and more terms. So if you just take the first 17 terms, the first 100 terms, or first 1,000 terms, you stop after a while. Is that going to give you a good approximation to your function? Or do you just have to take a ridiculously large number of terms to get close? In other words, how big is the error? And finally, we're going to look at what kind of functions cannot be written as infinite power series. Okay, so let's start with that first question. So the first question is, Taylor's theorem for analytic functions says that if you've got a function that's analytic, in other words, if you can write it as an infinite power series, by the way, you may have noticed that I'm calling the coefficient cn basically because a is the point that you're expanding around, and so I don't want to call it an. But whatever you call whatever name you give to the coefficients, if you can write it as an infinite power series, we're expanding in powers of x minus a, then the coefficients are given by a simple formula. You take the nth derivative of your original function, evaluate it at a, and divide by n factorial. In other words, you can write an analytic function as an infinite power series. You just compute the derivatives, divide by n factorial, multiply by the appropriate power, add them all up, and you get back your original function. Okay? It's convenient to look at the first few terms. The zeroth derivative is just the value of the function. So you always start off with f of a. Then you take the first derivative times x minus a. By the way, you might recognize that's the equation for the tangent line. So it says, if all you know about the function is its value, that gives you a guess. If you know its derivative, you can track its tangent line and get a better guess. If you know its second derivative, you can add another term and get a better guess. If you add the third derivative and fourth derivative and fifth derivative and so on, you get this infinite power series, all based on the derivatives. The other thing to notice in this formula is it starts at n equals 0. So the zeroth derivative is just the function. 0 factorial is defined to be 1. The reason is that for any number, you want n factorial to be n times n minus 1 factorial. So 1 factorial should be 1 times 0 factorial. But 1 factorial is 1. So that means that 0 factorial has to be 1. Okay. So why does this work? Well, we learned last time about how to take derivatives of power series and to evaluate them. So if we have f of x as a power series, what is f of a? Well, f of a is going to be c0 plus c1 times 0 plus c2 times 0 squared plus c3 times 0 cubed and so on. So the value of the function has to be c0. Now we turn that around. We say c0 has to be the value of the function at a. The derivative of a power series, we learned that you can take a derivative term by term as long as you're inside the radius of convergence. So the derivative is, well, the derivative of c0 is 0. The derivative of c1 times x minus a is c1. The derivative of c2 x minus a squared is 2c2 times x minus a, and so on. If you plug in x equals a, you get that the derivative at a is c1. So that means that c1 must be the derivative at a, which is also the derivative divided by 1 factorial. You take a derivative again, and you figure out that the derivative is 2c2 plus stuff. You evaluate that at a, and you get that that 2c2 is the derivative, so c2 is half the derivative. Keep going. And after you take derivative k times, you discover that the kth derivative, well, you pull down a whole bunch of powers. You start off with x minus a to the nth. So you take a derivative once, you get an n. Derivative again, you get a power of n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, n minus k plus 1. And the leading term is the term that had started off being x to the k. You take derivative k times, you get k factorial times ck plus the higher order stuff. You evaluate this at x equals a, and you just get k factorial times ck. So that means that ck must be the kth derivative divided by k factorial. And that's what we wanted to prove. If you call it n instead of k, that is the end of Taylor's theorem for analytic functions.